Beep bop boop bop beep up bop bop boop beep. Hello and welcome to Hugh's Reviews, the place for movie views and spoiler clues. I have loved Star Wars for as long as I can remember. It thrills me to think about the first time I set eyes on the Death Star, or how bad I wanted a lightsaber. Heck, I still want one. With The Rise of Skywalker coming out this week, I decided to set myself a challenge and watch the old films with fresh eyes. A difficult task to be sure. Do they still hold up? Can they resonate divorced from nostalgia? And so, from A New Hope to Return of the Jedi, this is Star Wars. To get a true sense of the films, I watched the original theatrical versions, which, if you're lucky, you can still find on VHS or Laserdisc. Special editions be damned, this is how you should come at these movies. As originally viewed, as originally seen in their time. Short of a private theater and a 40-year-old roll of celluloid, this is as close as you can get to the truth. While revisiting these films, a thought occurred to me. For facts, you go to history books. For where we are as a culture, you go to the movies. Star Wars has penetrated the consciousness of film more than any other series in modern history, and for good reason. When it premiered in 1977, it let us know that the crushing disillusionment of preceding decades could fade. It gave us permission to smile without irony, to hope without cynicism, to cheer without reservation. There was hope on the horizon. The original Star Wars is not a simple self-contained effort from the erstwhile imagination of one man, but a distillation of concepts that have infused all the artistic works of humankind. In fact, Star Wars can trace its own bloodlines back to the most ancient of dramas and comedies, the poetry and wonder of Greek tragedy, the Bible with its spiritual warriors, saviors, and kings, the immortal works of Beethoven and Mozart, and the technique of film masters too numerous to count. George Lucas and his cohorts may have drawn inspiration from these sources, but the truths of the human condition always remain the same. And with Star Wars, Lucas gave us a beautiful representation of those truths. The opening text crawl sets the tone for what you're about to see. John Williams' music slams the audience to attention, and the prologue soars away into the cosmos, instantly placing in your mind how vast this universe is. The pan across the starfield, brilliant in its technically difficult execution, also implies that the story will be unexpected. And the imposing shots of the Imperial Star Destroyer bearing down on the fleeing Rebel spaceship shows the might of the Empire and the weakness of the Rebellion. In a few short moments, using a few simple camera tricks, you instinctually know everything you need to know about the Rebel plight. This entire sequence almost never happened, but Lucas was as much of a rebel as the film's heroes, and when the Directors Guild insisted he alter it to include traditional opening credits, he refused, resigning from the guild and paying a fine rather than change a single frame. After its stunning overture, Star Wars seems at first to be about the two droids, R2-D2 and C-3PO, which were based on characters from Kurosawa's The Hidden Fortress. We don't even meet our main protagonist until well past what should have been seen as appropriate. In America in the late 70s, most directors were only starting to come around to the notion that character and story could be assumed in an abstract manner, and science fiction and fantasy were still seen as the realm of calculator watching nerds or cartoons. While Star Wars was discarded by some onto the same frivolous heap at the time, it has since proved to be anything but. Many of today's blockbusters, with their easy access to digital technology, have forgotten how evocative the camera can be. But when George Lucas made Star Wars, he was a young man, barely out of film school, who still had etched upon his brain the timeless lessons gleaned from his directorial heroes. Perhaps he was unaware of what he was doing, as later he seemed to forget those lessons, but we see in Star Wars how something as simple as camera placement can cause the audience to understand dominance, weakness, despair, triumph, and a whole host of other emotions without ever saying a word. Film is, after all, a visual medium, and Lucas did everything he could to utilize the power at his command. Star Wars was disregarded as childish pop culture by many serious critics at the time, and familiarity has caused most audiences to put it right back into that pile. But the way this film plays out is a class in great camera work. Take a look at any given shot in the film and you know the emotions presented, even if you don't know the film itself. Picture, for instance, the moment when Luke looks to the setting suns, bemoaning his lot and wishing for more. This is a unique human desire, nearly as deeply ingrained as reproduction, burned into our very genetic code. The unquenchable urge to push beyond boundaries and know the unknowable, to ignore what cannot be done, and then to do it. But when given the opportunity to achieve his dreams, Luke shrinks back, making excuses to disguise his fear. Everyone who has ever faced the choice between safety and growth knows his innermost thoughts, and they have little to do with the reasons he gives. With the sunset scene, we get all of those elements without a word being spoken. The importance of John Williams' music in helping bring these scenes to life cannot be overstated. It has long been rumored that an initial screening of the film before the music was added was disastrous, and it's not hard to see why. Williams' music is as much a part of Star Wars as the human heart is a part of the circulatory system. Without the pump and thrum of the heart, the body cannot survive. And without the swell of the music, Star Wars is merely some pretty pictures about space wizards with laser swords. Imagining Star Wars without the music of John Williams is like imagining summer without the sun. The camera shows us the moments, and they are beautiful, but the music opens our hearts to their truth. Now, the follow-up to a groundbreaking movie is typically disappointing. You can think of any number of examples without my prompting. But when Empire Strikes Back premiered in 1980, it destroyed critical expectations as surely as a well-placed proton torpedo. Those who dismissed the first film could not, in any good conscience, dismiss the second. Most sequels seek to recreate the original film, but Empire expanded on the ideas presented and delved deeper into character, philosophy, and motivation. Not only was it a slicker and wiser movie, but the effects team director Irvin Kershner assembled broke barriers hitherto undreamed of. While Star Wars had evoked the masters of the past, Empire gave audiences a brilliant look at the future. Take, for instance, the chase through the asteroid field. At one point, over 125 individual shots are hand-layered one atop another, and it is absolutely seamless. Even after all our technological advancements, there are effects in this film that hold up better than most digi-heavy films in recent memory. But again, what made it so astounding was not only the film craft or the effects, but the subversion of expectations with the characters. After all, as Lucas himself once mused, an effect without a story is a pretty boring thing. Rather than take the easy way out and have them come into the sequel fully formed, we see our heroes are still growing. Han and Leia, who gave off sparks of attraction in the first film, are now deflecting their desire into anger. That the ice planet of Hoth wasn't instantly melted by their heat is a mystery. This idea of two people who are attracted to one another while putting up a pretense of hatred is now a painful trope, wielded with blunt ferocity by lesser filmmakers. In Empire, they recall subtler, more sensually discreet films of the past. What modern films have yet to overcome is the balance between consent and seduction. There is a reason why most sex scenes today are pathetically passionless. If modern screenwriting committees had their way, they'd never risk offending anyone, and every sex scene would have a 5-hour prologue where the interested parties sat down with their lawyers and signed off on how many times who could spank what and how hard. That, or they just rip their clothes off and bump uglies before the audience or the characters know why anyone should care. Modern film romance has all the intimacy of a porno. The exchange of bodily fluids has replaced genuine human connection, and the average script of a romantic comedy would drown in the depth of a teacup. What Han and Leia experience in their one stolen moment in the service corridor has more fire than anything I've seen in the last 2 decades, and it does so while everyone still has their clothes on. Han's final line in the film, an ad-lib by Harrison Ford, is to this day the most perfect conclusion to such a romantic arc. It is amazing that Lucas did not alter it when he created his special editions of the trilogy, but maybe even George knew perfection when he saw it and wouldn't dare to touch such brilliance. Luke Skywalker is equally as nuanced. Rather than being a fully fledged Jedi Master, he is barely more adept than when we last saw him. He is still finding his way not only as a Jedi, but as a person. In writing the script, Lawrence Kasdan must have instinctually known that even the greatest natural talent needs molding, just as the greatest artworks might need a few more touches of the chisel or brush. But the way the brush is used sparingly here, never overwhelming the purpose of the picture, is what makes Empire so great. Luke, Han, and Leia are at their core the same people we came to know in the first film. This brings me to Hugh's movie rule number 3. Stay true to the essence of your characters and you will rarely go wrong. And understanding the essence of character also goes to the heart of the diminutive Yoda. Where Lucas evoked mythology, kitsch, and classic technique in his first film, Kasdan and Kershner decided to play with new inspirations. Through a deft mixture of harsh realism, mind-destroyingly intricate effects, and goofy kung fu film caricatures, they took what could have been a parody of childish wonder and created the stuff of legend. This was a dangerous gambit, but one that paid off in spades. Rather than being physically imposing, Yoda is, at his introduction, a laughable fool, testing Luke's heart. How a person treats his lesser is more telling than how he treats his master, after all. We see through their initial interactions that Luke still has a good heart, and Yoda, while cryptically terrifying in later scenes, has a childish sense of whimsy. This whimsy could have broken a lesser film, but Frank Oz's performance, the Henson shopwork, and the stinking, writhing, muck-filled set design combined to give us one of the most demanding characters of the 20th century. Yoda is, at the odd moment, a clown, a sage, or a villain. No greater balance has been found in a single character since, and this is delivered through the eyes and twitches of the million-dollar version of a sock puppet. With three words, he can send shivers down my spine. And any fan knows what three words those are. Words fail me to describe the perfection of this creation. In the first film, Luke is shown to be impatient and headstrong. In the second film, he is shown the need to control that impulse. Unfortunately, he doesn't understand that lesson until it's too late. He follows his heart, and it's a good heart. But his impetuousness spells doom for himself, his image of the truth, and his friends. The use of color in Empire is breathtaking and works as much as the dialogue and the acting to create the story. From the gray-blue whites of Hoth, we not only see the ice, we feel the chill of it. Dagobah's dark, claustrophobic blacks and browns make us feel smothered. The pure, glowing whites of Cloud City let us know we're approaching the altitude of heaven. And the obsidians, reds, and sharply contrasting blues when Luke confronts Vader show us just how close heaven can be to hell. The culmination of their battle, though long since fallen into parody, was at the time such a shocking revelation that children and adults alike gasped in horror as Luke screamed his agonizing acceptance of the truth. Vader's final moment on the screen, played out in near silence, is almost enough to turn the audience from hating and fearing him to pitying him. There is more to this skull-faced monster than we realized. The closing shot of the film is the sum total of all that has come thus far. The camaraderie, the impossibility of the hero's mission, the revelations they have faced, and all that they have yet to overcome. There is a whole universe out there, and more than they bargained with before they can wrest it from the clutches of evil. But hope still sings in their souls, even while doubt would seek to overtake their hearts. Scenes from this film have long since passed into satirical snickering, but when you watch Empire with fresh eyes, it reveals layer upon layer of what makes a truly timeless movie. If the original Star Wars was a sweeping epic, and Empire was a monumental leap forward in modern cinema, The Return of the Jedi, the third film of the originals, was a bit of a step sideways. It was still an enjoyable film, and certain scenes resonate as some of the greatest in the series, but the grand scope and vigor seemed sucked out. Action does not equal energy, and though there are great action sequences, like the speeder bike chase on Endor and the final space battle with the incredible effects and camera work, there isn't enough juice left to go around. It was as if, in spite of having all this fast-paced stuff going on, the director siphoned off bits of life from those scenes and poured it into the opening scenes in Jabba the Hutt's palace and the final showdown between Luke, Vader, and the Emperor. That's not a problem, per se, as those scenes certainly deserve their weight, but the rest of the movie is just a passable lark by comparison. The acting in Return of the Jedi also seems a bit off. Some critics mocked the acting of the leads in the first film as amateurish, but I've always seen their performances as raw and realistic. It always clashed appropriately with the refinement of classically trained old hands like Peter Cushing and Alec Guinness, though it was obvious Guinness knew from the start the type of film he'd been reduced to being in, and played his part with eye-rolling condescension at starring in a kiddie flick. But in Return of the Jedi, the heroes feel, well, off. Ford famously wanted to kill Han Solo off, but when he was forced to return to the role, he was none too pleased. That shows in how Solo seems more like a kid snickering at being in a school play than the hardened pirate we know from before. Fisher becomes more of an object of desire than a power in herself, in spite of her actions in Jabba's palace, and some of her lines seem forced and tired. Hamill, apparently told that Jedi have to be stoic, comes across as stiff. Only in his action scenes or his battle of wills in the Emperor's throne room does he truly come alive. The rest of the time, he's melodramatic and monotone. Some of these are acting choices, and some are directing choices. It's difficult to say which is which, but the overall effect diminishes the characters. Return of the Jedi is also more childish than the others, and yes, that partially means the Ewoks, which were a last-minute replacement for a proposed Wookiee army after they realized they didn't have the time or budget to carry that off. Until the later films came out, the image of a bunch of teddy bears taking down Imperial shock troops was the silliest thing in the franchise. Maybe the studio thought we needed a lighthearted palate cleanser after the brooding atmosphere of Empire, but the tone is uneven and the movie suffers for it. In spite of these issues, Return of the Jedi is still an enjoyable movie, a technically brilliant movie, and it has that special spark that makes a film feel uniquely Star Wars. It has my favorite lightsaber battle of any film in the franchise, classic or new, as with every swing and strike, the unbridled emotional intensity of the duelist is a hammer's blow to the heart. Vader's final moments are brilliantly touching, giving closure and peace to both hero and villain in the midst of tragedy, recalling the mythologies that inspired the story in the first place. You know, it's been a long road getting from a lonely farm on Tatooine to where we are now, and whatever you may think of it, you cannot deny that Star Wars and the cinematic empire built around it has permeated pop culture and film craft to such a degree that it's questionable if any action, sci-fi, or fantasy film since has been unaffected. Everyone who takes up a camera and looks to the future owes a nod of acknowledgement and gratitude to a man named George Lucas and the innumerable people who fought to bring us one of the greatest stories ever put to film. Since this exploration of the original trilogy ran a bit over, I'll have to address the prequels at another time. And with the final chapter in the Skywalker saga being released by Disney this week, I'll be able to give that film my full attention next time. And even though there's so much more to say, that is going to have to be it tonight for Hugh's Reviews. As always, I'd like to thank Moons of Vega Photography and the Central PA Computer Nerd for their continued support. If you have any thoughts on Star Wars or would just like to suggest a movie for me to review, you can find me on SoundCloud or drop me a line at WXPI Radio of Williamsport. May the Force be with you, and as always,
happy viewing!